Hey YouTube, so I want to do a video on an important study that you should be aware of. This video will be to introduce you to an important concept of microbiome. So not only am I going to introduce you to the microbiome, which is a collection of microbes inside of your gut, so bacteria, yeast, fungi, archaea, and probably species we don't know anything about, but I'm also going to talk to you about how you improve your microbiome. And I'm going to do this all in the setting of an important study. Okay, so stick around for the video so you can get what you got to do to improve your microbiome and keep from harming it. And also the important stuff is right away in the study. Okay, so what they did in this study is they took a group, two groups of people. Okay, they fed them very different diets. They started the one, gave them a lot of fiber-rich foods. Okay. So in this group, they got nuts, seeds, beans, legumes, vegetables, and fruit. High fiber foods, okay? It's pretty typical. You hear about high fiber content. They gave them that. And then they gave another group fermented foods, okay? So they gave them things like fermented sauerkraut, kimchi, fermented vegetables, fermented vegetable juice called brine, kefir, fermented milk, yogurt, and cheese. So these were basically, they were fermented foods. So two groups, one fiber rich, the other one fermented. Now, why did they do this study? They wanted to look at which manner of eating increased the diversity of the microbes, okay? So generally, what is perceived, seemed to be associated with a greater level of health is a greater level of diversity. Okay, so the more diverse your microbes inside your gut, generally the more healthy you are. So a good analogy for the microbiome, particularly in this aspect of diversity, is a safari. Okay, an African safari that was just made up of lions and zebra is not good, no bueno. But an African safari made up of everything else, prairie dogs, hyenas, alligators, crocodiles, birds, leopards, rhinos, hippos, lots of different species, okay? Now that is a healthy safari, okay? Takes a lot of species, you know, a lot of diversity to make that safari, or another analogy is the Amazonian rainforest, okay? Lots of species that contribute to the diversity and overall health of those environments. Same thing with your gut environment, okay? You don't want just one species of organism, you want a diversity. Now, my own personal thoughts, just for a moment, is you want a healthy diversity. It doesn't do any good to have a diversity of really bad things. You gotta have diversity of really good things, okay? So it's not just diversity, but it's also the composition. And so how you eat and what you eat and how you live your life, makes contributions towards that microbiome. But guess what? We're just starting to find out about, we haven't mapped it out. There's 30 to trillion of these, you know, organisms inside of you. So we don't know what they are. We don't know what they do. We're just starting to find this out. But you can make decisions. The healthier your decisions, the healthier your microbiome. The healthier your microbiome, the healthier you are, okay? So it's really important. So back to this study, having taken that little sidestep. This study looked at these two groups, fiber-rich and ferments, and they wanted to see which one became more diverse. And they also wanted to see if any of them provided any benefit in terms of decreasing inflammation, all right? So what they looked at was 19 different protein molecules. Of these 19 protein molecules, they followed them, they were associated with inflammation, different levels of disease. One of them is a big player called interleukin 6, IL-6. Now, IL-6 is associated with some bad players, obesity, diabetes, rheumatoid arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's. So these are bad inflammatory conditions. And these markers are seen in these conditions. So what they found out in this particular study, when they looked at these inflammatory protein molecules and the diversity, there was a big difference between the two groups. So what did they find out with diversity? The ones who ate the ferments had significant improvement in the diversity. So they increased the diversity. The other group, the fiber-rich group, no improvement in diversity, no change. Now that came as a big surprise. They expected that those things like fiber, fruits and vegetables and nuts and things like that would increase diversity. If there was no increase in diversity seen. Now, how about with regard to inflammation? Of those 19 molecules, the ones that ate the ferments had lower levels of these markers of inflammation. They were lowered. And in the fermented group, it was dose dependent, meaning the more ferments they ate, the less the inflammation and the greater the diversity. Now, what about inflammation from eating fruits and vegetables and seeds and nuts and beans and grains, right? No benefit. Not one of the 19 markers of inflammation were lowered from eating the fiber-rich diet. So this was a strong suggestion about the preference in the microbiome and inflammation to eat a fermented diet, eat ferments. And there was no observed benefit to eating the fiber-rich diet. So real quickly, these, I gotta get through this, okay? These are fermented foods, okay? Sauerkraut, it can't be pasteurized. This stuff has to be sold in the refrigeration section of a grocery store, okay? You're not gonna buy this off the shelf, okay? This has to be refrigerated because it's living and it keeps fermenting. So right away, if you're shopping in the middle of the store, you're wrong. You gotta get to the refrigeration section where ferments really are kept because they're ongoing, okay? And kimchi is a great one. And then fermented brines, okay? So fermented kvass, beet juice is an important. Here's fermented beets, okay? K-V-A-S-S. Fermented beet juice and miso. And then as far as fermented dairy, you know, there's kefir, K-E-F-I-R. There is fermented yogurt, even fermented apple cider vinegar. So let me give you a tip. These ferments ferment in dark, okay? Nobody's talking about this. They're all out in stores, and even this right now. See all this light on it? No bueno. You want to put these microbes, and you want to cover them up so that light is not, you know, diminishing them, okay? Because the light kills these organisms. You can't ferment them and they're harmful to it. So when you buy this in the store, reach in the back, grab those jars in the very back. Don't look the ones in the front with all the bright light shining on them. They're going to have less living microbes in them, less beneficial for you. So you want to buy them in the back, put them in your refrigerator. And when it comes to apple cider vinegar, you want to store this in a dark cabinet, okay? And make sure it's always non-pasteurized. With apple cider vinegar, you want to look for the term the mother on it. Brad's is a good brand. I don't have any association whatsoever. I never will have any association. I want to promote something for money because I just promote health, okay? So all this stuff is just an example. All right, so that's what I'm talking about. Now, to keep from harming it, don't drink chlorinated water. You know, chlorinated water goes down. Don't eat processed foods. That's food preservatives to keep bacteria from causing food to be stale. So you don't want to do that. Antibiotics disrupt your microbiome. Only take an antibiotic if you absolutely need to. Say to a physician or some medical provider, do I really need to? How about I come back and see you tomorrow rather than taking this antibiotic? Okay, can I do that? Or how about I come see you in 3 hours? You know, whatever. You know, check in telemedicine. So you don't have to take an antibiotic. You can follow up and see if it's really, really necessary. Okay, so those are some basic strategies. I told you about fermented foods. I told you about this study. As always, if you have comments, please leave them. If you have questions, I love questions. I learn a lot from them. Please give me questions. If you like this video, give it a like, subscribe to it, and share with somebody else who needs to benefit from knowing maybe they're just eating, you know, a high fiber rich diet. Maybe you need to share with them about fermented foods. Now, when it comes to fermented foods, if you don't have a taste for it, here's a little tip, okay? You don't have to eat a whole bowl of it, okay? Take a little bit of fermented foods, just open up the jar, stick your finger in it, okay? When you stick your finger in it just a tiny bit, lick your finger and swallow it with non-chlorinated water, okay? Get those microbes in there. You're not eating the food as much as you're eating microbes, okay? So that little tip helps you to colonize your gut. When they start living in you, then you're not going to hate it so much, okay? These microbes influence our tastes and how we live and our selection for food. When you got a lot of bad microbes inside, they're going to tell you hate these ferments. So if you are somebody that hates the concept of sauerkraut or kimchi or unsweetened yogurt or fermented kvass, things like that, you probably have bad microbes in you. And you need to start with a very, very small amount. Just dip your finger in that little bit of jar of kimchi juice. Lick it and swallow it with non-chlorinated water, spring water. Get it down there, and gradually over a period of time, as you do that more and more, you're going to be colonized. You'll be able to handle that. Okay, this is my suggestions about how to improve your microbiome. It's probably the single most exploitable area that you need to work on to optimize your health. Everything is affected by sleep, how you exercise, how you fast, what you eat, what you don't eat, stress. Everything affects the microbiome. The microbiome affects you. You are more other organisms than you are yourself. Okay, hope you enjoyed this video. Share it with somebody else. Thanks very much.